I can share you this as well. Okay.
Yes.
So yeah. So I was talking about the develop code. When you are a developer, you used to write lots of code, piece of code which is actually not required for production. For example, if I say whether this code is a production ready code, just say somebody saying write a hello world programming for a production. Production, when I say the actually your software is deployed in the system where your actual user is using. For example, the ATM software. So this ATM software is first in the development phase, then it is coming in the QA phase, then it is coming in the UAT phase, then it is coming to the production phase. So if you talk about the different phases in the industry, how its work is basically, so first is dev, called development okay. environment. If development is done and developer has the testing from their side, then it is going to the QA environment. QA is nothing but you can also say testing environment, quality analyst, where your quality analyst is going to test the whole project features developed under that software and making sure that there is no bug or things. If issue and bugs are there, it is immediately going to be reported to the development team, and development team is going to take an action to resolve that. Then after, if QA is giving sign of, yeah, everything starts working fine, because this guy have to write a lots of test cases. So in the industry, we have a developer, another side, we have a tester as well. So whoever is a tester, they used to write a lots of test cases related to automation, you know, manual testing, automation testing. And we have a tool like, what are the tools for testing, manual testing? I forgot the name. But as a developer, you are also going to write a test, and that test case is coming under the JUnit. So we used to say JUnit test. And if you go to the many organizations, especially the product-based company, they are very much conscious about the test cases, especially the JUnit test cases. If I get time, definitely I will help you with that JUnit, how to write a JUnit test cases as a developer. So the meaning itself is saying unit testing. What is the meaning of unit testing in the sense is the unit of your code, the unit of your business logic, whether it is working as expected or not. So that's called unit testing, and that have to be taken care by the developer. After that, it's coming QA, and QA is saying, okay, fine, now everything is resolved, things are fine, project is meeting the expectation, then it is coming to UAT. UAT is not, it's something like user before production. UAT, I forgot the full form. So basically, we are saying UAT full form is user acceptance testing. Okay, so this UAT user is actually a real user, but they are going to just test your features. For example, let's say somebody has developed the ABC project and the customers are using this. Now, suddenly the requirement came that this ABC project is not working functionally. It is a legacy technology used. So they have used the new ABC. This is a new project. Now you cannot directly go and replace the ABC with the new ABC because it's a production. This application is already tested and it is serving the user request. So what is the process? You have to bring some of the users from the production and you will tell them, hey, I have developed a new ABC project, which is more faster, having the latest technology. It will give you a good feeling, but I cannot directly go and replace your production application ABC. So I want you to help me for a testing, user acceptance testing. So now this UAT environment is going to play with some real-time data. This development environment can have a fake data. It's not a genuine data. It is a junk data. Even in the QA also, you don't have the actual data. But when it's come to the UAT, it is kinds of real data. Kinds of. Again, I'm saying it's not the actual real data. And when UAT people are saying, okay, fine, it looks good, then it is coming to broad environments called production environment. So under production, once you are saying production, then it means that now user can do their business logic. I mean, whatever business they are doing, they can now perform onto this new ABC, and you can decompose the previous ABC instance. So this is how the life cycle of a project is going in high level. I will talk about in the more details for life cycle requirement analysis, you know, coding, testing, implementation, deployment, all these things. But yeah, this is the high level things. So what I was trying to tell you here is the Hello World programming, which you have written here, it is perfect for development. But can we deploy this in the production? Answer is no. And what is wrong with this? This line, system.out.println. If you look at the any production ready code, if you go to the industry, and if you will never see in your project, there is some system.out.println. I will tell you why not in some time, but in any real-time project, if you found system.out.println, trust me, that is a bad coding. Somebody has not reviewed that code. Now, what is wrong with that system.out.println? We as a code Java developer, we had played around the system.out.println only. We don't know the other option to print the output, right? What is the alternative for that? And why system.out.println is not recommended in the production ready code? Why we should not write the system.out.println in my project? Reason is, in computer world, you know that we have an operating system. And operating system is going to handle the complete resources like your RAM, memories, all these things. So there is something called input-output operation. What's that? Input-output operation. When you are performing any input-output operation, means it is going to the operating system level. You are requesting something to the operating system. An operating system is giving a response back. So when it's come to the operating system, it means you are dealing with the memory or you are dealing with the RAM or whatever is there. And what are the moment is memory, it's a hardware. So ideally from your software programming, when you are interacting with the hardware, that's called input-output operation. And operating system is not bounded only for this Eclipse and Java. They have lots of processes running in their system. So what will be? Operating system can tell you, hey, hello, wait. Let's, for example, you are saying that print this hello world and the output is coming to this console. It is one of the terminal. You know this? Printing this output, the system.out.println is going to the operating system and saying that, hey, I need to print these things. Can you help me with this output operation? What operating system is saying? Okay, wait in the queue because I already have some process to run. I will get it. You will get a chance. You print that. So your actual processing is waiting for that. And that's called input-output operation. It's not input, but it's the output operation. And Java is one of the object-oriented programming languages. Whereas if you talk about the C, C++ and all, these all are assembly-based programming languages. So hardware interaction is much more faster in C, C++ than Java. So whenever in industry people are getting a project or developing a software, the first things they are thinking is, what kind of software are we going to make? Let's say somebody is asking you, we'll develop a program for printer. Are we going to select Java? Probably it will be a bad choice. Why? Because it's a printer program, it's a printer software, so there is a much more hardware interaction there. And Java will be not the right choice there. So people preferred C++. But somebody is saying, hey, I want to develop a web application. Whether C++ will be the right choice? Answer is no. It will be a bad choice. Because we have a lots of request response kinds of things. Idea is, as a developer, if we don't know our piece of code, how it's internally reacting into the operating system, it is waste of learning the things. You cannot write any piece of code which can cause performance issue. These all are the performance issue. Why it's performance issue? Of course, it's a time consuming. If you write an algorithm, when you learn the data structure and algorithm, whenever you are writing an algorithm, there is always two scenarios, time complexity and space complexity. initial days, we were not having the memory also much. So we need to bother about the space complexity also. Sometimes, in fact, we have to compromise with the time rather than spaces. Think about the gaming software. They need good amount of spaces because at the end it's running in a mobile, and mobile it might have some limited memory. So their space matters. But now we are in the world of cloud, where space doesn't matter. We have a huge memory. Now what we matter is time complexity. Can we compromise time complexity? Answer is no. It's a crime. You should never allow to compromise with the time complexity. And when I say time complexity, the meaning is, based upon your input increase, your algorithm is taking time. So if you guys are doing mastering, definitely you will get this, or you might be knowing this. We have a big O of N, big O constant time. We have a log N, we have an N square, all these things. And I will highly recommend you. These are the fundamental. Spring Boot is a technology which can come and it can go. It's a framework. There's no chance that it can be survived in the future also. There might be some better framework at Kanam, it can replace that. Because we were having the GSF framework, we were having the Portlet framework, we were having the Struts framework, but Spring has got popularity and all this old framework is gone. So we cannot commit that Spring will be forever. In fact, we cannot commit for Java. But Java is having somehow, you know, they are very smart. Always they are in the highlight the reason. Whatever new features are coming, they are going to include it into their new version. So that's the reason it is serving and serving and serving. So whatever new programming language come with some new idea, for example, Python came with the functional programming language. Java people thought, oh, if I not include these features in my Java, then might be our user will be start going to the Python or another functional programming language. So in Java 8, they have included the Lambda. And Lambda is nothing but it's completely a functional programming language. So that's the reason Java is still in the market and they are keep on enhancing the new features. By the way, yes. So I was talking about that input-output operation. System.out.println is completely going to the operating system and asking, hey, give me that your console access so that I will print this output. And if you have a lots of system.out.println, then you have to remove these all things. It's not good practice. Now question is, how can I print the output? Ideally, in the real-time system, you don't need to print the output. What you need to print the logs to make sure that your application is working as expected. And for that purpose, we have a lots of logging framework like log4j, slf4j, logback, all these things. So that's the purpose they have developed this logging framework. System.out.println is not allowed, but most of the developer while developing, they need to test that whether our call is reaching here or not. They used to put the system.out.println. So as an architect, when I review their code, then I used to find out, I will say, hey, remove the system.out.println. Guys, it is boring to you, then I can directly jump into the technology. But I feel that as a developer, you should know all these things. Nikhil, are you with me?
Yes, please. Yeah.
What were you, Vasavi? Getting or it's completely going?
Yeah. No, that is.
Okay, cool. Well, so I was just showing to the Vashbi how many things you can learn into the core Java itself. Nikhil, do you know this three dots meaning?
So basically, what I know is using the brackets and stuff. So I didn't know about the three. Yeah, that one. Yeah,
you know what
is that?
Yes, so this is one of the variable arguments. And see, your program is running perfectly. So there's lots of things in the core Java also, guys. Trust me. Because core Java, you have to have a very good command in that. Anyway.
Right.
So let's move ahead with the advanced Java. But I want to put some background. Like, what is the meaning of advanced Java? So when you come to the Java, basically, you have a three version. What is that? J2SE.
Standard edition, enterprise edition, and micro edition.
J2ME, very good. So this standard edition is nothing but your core Java. And J2E is the enterprise edition, which is your advanced Java. So under this, we have a servlet, GSP, Spring, MVC, all these things. Now, Hibernate also you can consider the advanced Java, because, but it's actually a core Java project. You don't need to do lots of fancy things here. If you write a simple Java application, you can still achieve the Hibernate things.
Right.
Yes, J2ME is micro edition, and especially it's required in the mobile world development. So Android and all are coming under that. So right. Core Java, you guys know, and this is the prerequisite things for learning the advanced Java. You guys have registered for this J2E. Under that, you're going to learn how the advanced Java concept is. Under this advanced Java concept, I can tell you that I told you servlet. This is a legacy concept, but it's required to be known first. JSP. I can say XML. I can say Spring. Hibernate. Spring, when I say it's boot also, but I have mentioned it separately, right. Because now Spring Boot considered as a separate framework rather than the Spring framework. So these are the things you should know. Now, can we develop our whole project into the core Java? Answer is yes. You can do that. In core Java, there is a two concept called applet and swing. Have you heard about this two concept in core Java?
I've heard about the applet, but not swing.
Yes. So applet swing is again a legacy technology, I can say. It's completely deprecated. When I say deprecated, okay. Nobody is using now this day. It's completely right. Gone from the market. But in the olden days, whenever you want to design your UI, we were not having HTML and all these things, fancy things that time too much. So people were designing this like this. So if you look at, if you go to your Google and search for login page in Swing, go to images, it looks like something like this. You know, so this right. Is the UI developed in the core Java. The application which is only developed in core Java known as a desktop application.
Right.
And what are the desktop application? If you're going to the mall and all, you must have seen the billing software. They're just scanning and printing the bill and all, right? So those kinds of software is considered as a desktop application. But we are in the world of technology and the web application. So when I say web application, that's where you need advanced Java technology. Web in the sense internet, an application, you know, an application which is running on internet is known as web application. And in web application, basically we have two things. One is client and another one is the server. In web application, we have two major components, client and server, and two major tasks. What is that? Request and
response.
Now, who is client? Who is making a request is known as client. So for example, if you're going to the Facebook login and if you're clicking on a login, you are as a client. Technology wise, browser is a client. And who is server? Right. Whoever is processing a request and giving the response back to you, that's known as server. So this is the two major concept. And now this day, trust me, nobody wants to develop a desktop application. In fact, mall people also wants to have a desktop, not desktop, web application. Things are not centralized, it's distributed. We are in the world of distributed computing, cloud computing. So
okay,
whenever you want to develop a web application, you need to bother about these things. So first and most important things, what we're going to do now here is developing a simple Hello World servlet programming. And I will give you a feeling of how servlet programming was working. I'm saying was working in the sense now these days people are not using pure servlet and JSP because we have a good framework like Spring. But old days, there was no much technology. Only servlet and JSP was the option. And whatever web application we were developing, that all are coming from the servlet and JSP. So without any delay, let me open the some servlet example. Any question, guys? Anything so far? Whatever we have.
So I was not clear about the three dots that you used.
Oh, you were not about. This is called variable arguments.
Oh, that's a variable. Okay.
So you just read about it. It's a pretty simple concept.
Right.
You two, Vasavi, just both of you, the homework I'm giving to you is read about the variable argument. And in tomorrow class, first of all, I will discuss on this. And I will see how you have learned it. So that if you are missing something, I will update that.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Okay. No doubts. Okay. One more very, very important point. When you are in the world of web application, you need one web server. Web server is like Tomcat. You must have heard about Tomcat server. So we have a three kinds of server: web server, application server, and database server. Database server, again, you might be knowing MySQL, Oracle,
yes,
Sybase, DB2, all these things are the database server. Application server is JBoss, WebLogic. And web server is Tomcat, which is very much popular in the world of web application. So you might need to download the Tomcat server for this example, which I'm going to show you. So without any delay, I'm going to create one small web application in Eclipse. Nikhil, you are familiar with Eclipse, right?
Yes. Cool. So is it okay if I also use IntelliJ?
Yeah, that's not a problem. You can do that.
Okay.
Fine. So usually when you are developing a Java project in Core Java, what you should do? File, new, other, and here you are saying project, Java project, right? So you used to select this and you're developing a Hello World programming, whatever you want. But the moment you are in the advanced server or you are trying to develop a web application, then go here. First and most important things, you need to select the dynamic web project. Can you see that? This option is coming to you. Dynamic web project. To be very frank, guys, after a long time, I'm developing this dynamic web project because most of the time, the candidate which is reaching to me, they are experienced. And they have a specific requirement like Spring Boot and some standard tutorials expectation. But since you guys are just pass out, so yes, it's important for you to know the fundamental. If you don't know fundamental, there is a problem. So these all things are still used by Spring, but it's in background. If I directly teach you the Spring framework and Spring Boot, trust me, you will get it. I'm pretty sure you will get it. But the fundamentally, you will not understand how the flow is going from client to server, what is happening in the background. So what you need to do, file new dynamic web project. And here I'm just going to give a name as a Hello Servlet. And select the Tomcat version. So guys, this is not the paid version of Zoom meeting. So after 10 minutes, it can disconnect. So please rejoin again. Okay. The same link.
Okay.
Okay. Apache Tomcat 7.9 is invalid. In my Tomcat, I should get this. My Eclipse looks like not having the latest version of Tomcat. It's just giving the option me to. Okay, just a moment. Window preferences. Servers, runtime environments. There's so many Tomcat available. And this is not giving me option to delete by selecting all. Remove. No. This is the bug. I can't say bug. It's supposed to be a feature in Eclipse to select all and delete rather than one by one. So when I was teaching, that time Tomcat 7 was there, Java 7 was there, the hottest one and latest one also. But I surprised how this many Tomcat came here. These all are not. I have now Tomcat 9. Or I might have Tomcat 7 also, but I always prefer the latest one. You have a lot of learning there.
Great.
Okay. Now I'm saying add. Here is a Tomcat 9. Next, browse. Wherever you have installed Tomcat. So if you guys have not installed Tomcat, I will suggest you, please download the Tomcat. And how to download the Tomcat, I will also tell you. So now go to finish, apply and close. So how to download Tomcat? You just type here Tomcat 8.58 download, something like this. You will go to the Apache and here is the version 8.19. If you want, you can select the 8 also. Under 8, you will see a zip file. So just click on this zip file and Tomcat will be start downloading this. Okay. So that's what even I did, and I got this. This is my software. Under that, I have Tomcat 9 and extracted it. And this is the Tomcat 9 server. So for web application, the first and most important thing is that you must have a Tomcat server installed in your system.
Right.
Not necessarily install, at least you have a zip file. So let me give hello shelflet and new runtime already selected. If not, then you can click on this and Tomcat 9 or whatever version you have downloaded based upon that. Go to next, next, finish. So now, if you look at this project structure, this project structure is having the one additional folder called web content and the build folder. If you remember the Core Java project, in Core Java, you have a src and bean. Bean folder is holding the or compile dot class file and src stands for source, which is having the your Java class. Whereas in the web application, you are having one more folder called web content along with src. So whatever your static files in the sense HTML, JavaScript, CSS, all these files should go under this web content.
Right.
Now, let's develop a first simple servlet program. So what I have to do, src, right click, new, src, right click, new, and you can see one option here, servlet.
Okay.
Click on this. If you want to give some package name, give that. And give the class name. So I'm giving hello servlet. Next. Next. Uncheck the do post for time being. Click on finish. So Eclipse will automatically generate a ready-made template of your particular servlet class, and this is how your code is going to be looks like.
Okay.
So we have a constructor. We have, let me remove all this comment and all. I don't like the comments too much in my code. And we have a doGet. Remove this as well. Remove this as well. Control Shift F. Okay. Now, this is one of your server response class. Somebody will make a request to this class and it will give a response back. How that response going to be, that depends on your business logic, how you're going to write it. So for example, in this doGet method, I'm going to say, print writer key. System dot out dot println. I was right. So basically, it's a print writer out equal to response dot get writer and out dot print ln. Hello from servlet. And let's also have one system dot hello from servlet, and this is going to be console output. Now, as I told you, in a web application, you have a two major components, request and response, client and server, and yeah. Two major operations, request and response. So if you look at this doGet method, which is a predefined method, which I have overrided in my class, having the HTTP servlet request and HTTP servlet response. So whatever people are making a request to this servlet, they will send some data, which will be storing into this request, and whatever response you want to send, that will be going via this response object. Okay. Now, if I run this application, just go to this, right click, run as on server. Run on server. Next, finish. If your Tomcat is installed successfully, something like this, your Tomcat will be starting. And look at the output.
Right.
Hello from servlet. So in my code, I have a two output. One is out.println. So this is basically a browser output. Whatever you will write under this out.println, it will be going to the browser. Whatever you will write under the system.out.println, that will go under the console. That's the reason you